Why does the Bible say, don't give up hope? One reason is because your present suffering, whatever it is you're suffering right now, is mild or minor compared to your future glory. That's what Paul says in verse 18, where he says, this present sufferings are not worthy to be compared to the glory that's going to be revealed in us, future tense. Paul gives us some examples of why we ought to have hope. And the words drawing these three examples together is the word groan. And he talks about creation groaning. Then he talks about how we groan. And the third example of the Bible is that even the Holy Spirit groans in us in prayer. And for this series, we're just going to look at the first two hope examples. All of creation is groaning for a future renewal. When we talk about creation, let me explain. We're not talking about humankind, but rather the natural creation, what we call the world of geology, the rocks, the planet. It's the world of botany, the world of zoology, the animals that are not human. That's the world of nature. And what Paul says is that this whole world of nature is groaning. Something's wrong with it. There's something that's going to come in the future. And you may say, you never knew that the Bible taught what's going to happen to the earth in the future. But we're going to learn about that. What's going to happen to planet Earth in the future? Is it, as some people claim, the sun will one day stop burning and then we're going to go into another ice age and freeze?
Climate experts believe the next ice age is on its way. According to recent evidence, it could come sooner than anyone had expected. At weather stations in the far north, temperatures have been dropping for 30 years. Seacoasts long free of summer ice are now blocked year-round. According to some climatologists, within a lifetime, we might be living in the next ice age.
Are we going to continue to deplete the ozone layer until global warming takes over? What's going to happen to the actual physical planet? The Bible says creation is groaning. Now, let's learn what the Bible's saying about future creation. First of all of nature has been frustrated since the curse of man's sin. There's something wrong with nature. Let's look at Genesis, the third chapter. Remember what happened back in the first days to Adam? When God said, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you must not eat, cursed is the ground, the earth, because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat of it all the days of your life. Then notice it says, thorns and thistles will grow up. Now, did you know that before sin entered the world, there were no thorns, there were no thistles, no briars, no brambles? Everything was perfect and ideal. But ever since the fall of man and the curse of sin, something's been wrong with the earth. Everyone realizes that, whether they're Christian or not. I don't read a lot of French philosophy, but Godet wrote this about something being wrong with nature. Nature, with its melancholy chorus, resembles a bride who, at the very moment when she's fully dressed for marriage, has watched her groom die. She stands with her fresh crown in her bridal dress, but her eyes are full of tears. Godet says, that's what's wrong with nature. Listen to the song of the wind in the trees, the song of the surf on the seashore, to the very song the birds sing. Everything's in a minor key. The song of nature is in a minor key because something's wrong. This planet's been cursed because of sin. And because of that, the Bible says creation is groaning for something to happen. Let me tell you what's happened because of man's sin. Would you like to know where some of the bad stuff in this world came from? First of all, man's sin is responsible for natural disease. I'm sure you know someone or are related to someone who's been diagnosed with cancer. Those of you who are physicians, you know what cancer is. Those of you who've ever experienced cancer, have been fighters against cancer, or have had someone in your family fighting cancer, you understand. It's when the growth of cells deteriorates. and the cells don't reproduce as they should. It's a sickness at the cellular level. Where'd it come from? Well, I'm here to tell you that in the Garden of Eden, there was no disease. There was no death. It was as if when Adam and Eve sinned, a Pandora's box of human disease was released on the planet. And right now, you and I live under the fallout of the fall. Have you ever taken a medical examination for a life insurance policy? Many times they make you go to the doctor and they draw some blood and they ask you a lot of questions like, have you ever had diabetes? Have you ever had hypoglycemia? High blood pressure? Low blood pressure? Gallstones? Kidney stones? Have you ever had this? Have you ever had that? Look at the number of things that can go wrong with the human body because there's so much sickness and disease in the world today. Do you know where that came from? Man's sin. Man's sin is also responsible for natural disasters. Let me ask you this. Why are there tornadoes? Why are there hurricanes? I promise you that there were no tornadoes or hurricanes in the Garden of Eden, but man released a power, and since that time, all of nature has been frustrated. If you don't believe it, just read it. It's right there in verse 20. It says, "For the creation was subject to frustration." It's not creation's fault, not by its own choice, but by the will, the choice of the one who subjected it. And next time we'll continue talking more about creation's frustration. Thank you, Lord, for what you're teaching us. And I pray, Lord, that as we learn about creation, about nature, and the groaning that it makes, we would understand the hope that it has also. And I pray, Lord, that our hope, that our certainty in you would grow, and that we would understand that you have a plan and there's a future. In Jesus' name, amen.
One day you'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you will bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away. No. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.